Raghvendra. So please welcome Raghvendra to the big applause.
This is Raghvendra's session. The person I should say, the boy who is standing here, his name is Mr. Raghvendra N. Bhatt. His presentation is on Mathamaji music. Mathamaji music, I think very good to say that. Raghvendra N. Bhatt is going to perform a session on Mathamaji and music. He will also stress upon the benefits of ancient Indian mathematics in modern day life. He has given over 40 shows in the last 5 years all over the world, including the Indian Institute of Technologies in India and universities like Miami in the US. He has also been learning tabla and violin from the age of 10. He has been appreciated by mathematicians like Arthur Benjamin, who are world renowned. So with this, I present to you Mr. Raghvendra N. Bhatt, Mathamaji Music.
Before I begin, I would like to tell you a small story because of which I am here. It's been almost 5 years now. Am I audible to everybody? Without the mics? Okay. So it's been almost 5 years now since I started giving my presentations on maths and magic and music, and one of my first ever performances was organized by Professor Prabhu in Rotary Club of Udupi Manipal. That was I think in 2012. So from there, my actual journey began of giving talks, and it has taken me to all corners of the world. And today I am here again for the third time in this conference. So I would like to thank him a lot for giving me that opportunity that day, because of which I got so many other shows and I could meet so many people. So thank you so much, sir, for that.
Thank you.
So this show, I would like to give you some, pre-instructions. This is not going to be anything similar to anything that you've been hearing today or yesterday or day before. So don't expect me to derive some very complicated equations with nice symbols and proving that L is equal to RHS, or coming up with some out of the world ideas, some paper presentation, nothing of that sort. I'm here, I don't know, maybe somewhat like a break between your paper presentations, or to give you some extra thought on some things which you didn't think about till now, or some sort of an entertainment. So I'm here for that. I'm an amateur compared to the stalwarts sitting in the audience. They're all great people in their fields, and I really feel happy that I have the opportunity of presenting in front of you all. So my talk will be based on three things generally, okay? And coincidentally, all the three topics begin with the letter M, okay? They are mathematics, magic, and music. So that's why it's called Mathamagi Music. So that's what my show is titled, Mathamagi Music. Before I begin, the three words, mathematics, magic, and music, I already told you that M is common to all the three words. Can you tell me which other letters are also common? A is not there in music. Mathematic, magic, music. I. So M, C, and I are the three letters which are there in all the three words. Now if we code the letter to the number, in the sense just saying that A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, in that way, which letter of the alphabet is M?
13.
Which letter of the alphabet is C? 3. And which letter is I?
9.
I will write this letter twice. I was born on 13th of March 1999. I was born on 13th of March 1999, and that's probably the reason why I am fascinated about these three topics. Now, how many of you have been to some talk of mine in the last 5 years? Okay, not all of you, but fine. How many of you have been to the same conference talk of mine 2 years back or 4 years back?
Both.
Okay. So, I am very sorry if some of you might feel this is a repeat episode. I try my best to make you not feel that way, but I'm sure there will be something new this time. I'd like to begin by playing a small piece on the violin. I don't think I've played the violin in the last couple of shows, so. Actually, I also play the tabla, but due to the rainy season, my tabla has not been in a very good condition, so I couldn't bring it today. So please manage with one musical instrument for today. Okay, fine. I'd like to play a small piece on the violin so that we begin this program on a traditional note. I wish to seek blessings from all the elders present here, because every person here is older to me. And the people who have inspired me, my parents, my teachers, a world-renowned mathematician, Dr. Arthur Benjamin. By seeing his talk, I got inspired. And the late Srinivasan Ramanujan, who continues to be my source of inspiration in all Indian mathematicians. And also Professor Manjul Bhargava of Princeton University, who taught me through his talks that you can combine maths and music. So I want to take blessings from all these people, and I hope they will inspire me to give you a very good presentation. I would like to play a small piece on the violin.
Perfectly.
They believed in something and they would do anything in the world to not let that belief get affected. So that's why they needed mathematics, because mathematics is accurate. They could predict the date, first thing, the time, second thing, accurate to minutes when eclipses could happen, right? And nowadays our weather forecast is so bad that today morning somebody will tell you that it's a sunny day and then you don't take an umbrella, then it will rain. In spite of having satellites or telescopes, great astronomers all over the world, we are still not able to do it. Why are these people able to do this? Now, the food items which they ate at that point of time, I don't think there was any extra energy in it. Nor do I think they had some supernatural powers. Some of them might have. There are some people who say that Ramanujan used to get his ideas in his sleep, but those are all myths. There are proofs that he has written things down. We know that he actually had the mind. But why did the ancient mathematicians, what was there in them that made them achieve things like this? It's such a mystery, nobody knows. But we know that these things are true, because in the Vedas, you find theorems encoded in, you know, high-level Sanskrit, which no one can understand. So they have to write commentaries on that. So what is the meaning of a commentary? When a cricket match is going on, what does the commentator do? He tells us what is going on, because a normal person might not understand. So the commentator will tell what is the speed of the ball, what is the swing on it, what is the seam on it, shine on it, all those things. So same way, in these high-level Sanskrit scriptures, people used to code it and write it in slightly simpler language so that the layman could understand. And what texts are available to us right now, they are commentaries of commentaries of commentaries of the original text. So somebody would write a commentary and that itself would be difficult. So somebody would come up with a commentary for that commentary and that itself would be difficult. So there would be three or four such commentaries, and even the diluted version is in very high level Sanskrit. The verses which are one sentence long, when the commentary comes, there will be 2-3 pages long. So that type they used to write their discoveries. So it's very difficult. So I enjoy this camp for the reason that in this camp, the teaching is done in a very, very open sort of a unique way. Now in school, everything happens. I mean, okay, there are teachers who teach with the intent of teaching, but generally the outcome is that the syllabus has to be completed, the exam has to be, you know, given on time. So that's not their mistake. That's how the education system has been designed. But in this camp, for 5 days, we are taught concepts in a very unique way, and we are given the freedom to discover whatever we want, to ask any question in the world, and to ponder upon anything. And believe it or not, those 5 days we end up sleeping at 1 and getting up at 3, because we really don't want to miss that time. So we all sit together in groups, and every camp there has been some or the other discovery. Unfortunately, later on we find out that some of them are already discovered, but some things are new. And that happens because of the surrounding, because of the atmosphere, because of the mindset. We are able to openly think upon things. There's an 11-year-old who used to come for our camp. His name is Anurag. He is a genius. Now, when he's 11, he asks questions related to 10th standard, 11th standard mathematics. There's another girl who's 12 years old. She's a topper in the All India level exam. She solves trigonometric sums. So these kind of people come there and we all have a blast, literally. So there I learned so many things about ancient Indian mathematics which are used in modern day computers. So they had the binary concept was actually there long, long, long ago, using 1 and 0, true and false. And some of you might feel that 0 was discovered by Aryabhatta. So some people say that. I would like to tell you that it's not true. The concept of 0 came maybe in India. We're not very sure about that. But there are proofs of 0 existing in other civilizations as well. So you shouldn't go and tell somebody that Indians discovered 0 first or Aryabhatta discovered 0. That didn't be true all the time. But we know that the concept of 0 was there long, long, long ago. Why was the concept of 0 there? When you say the concept of 0, was it this 0 or was it this 0 or did it mean nothing? Now 0 means nothing, but when we say temperature is 0 degrees, does it mean that there is no temperature? No, right? 0 can have different meanings. If I tell you that I have 0 mobile phones in my hand right now, it means that I don't have any mobile phones. But if I tell you that the temperature is 0, it means that it is cold and it is freezing. Doesn't mean that there is no temperature. So which concept of 0 came up first? So that research mentality they create in our head in those camps. We ponder upon these kind of questions. We have debates for hours together on these kind of topics, and that makes it a wonderful experience. So if some of you wish to attend that camp, it's very, I feel it's an entertaining experience. The good thing is there is no age bar in that camp. So we find people from the age of 11, 12, 50, 60, 20, 30, all kinds of people. We meet the 50 people per camp and we enjoy it. So I want to tell you about one concept that I learned in that camp. Because permutations and combinations are a very, very important field in mathematics as well as in computer science. So in music, what happens is, the ancient scholars, they were very big patrons of art and music and you know all that. So nowadays what you find out is that the mathematician, the high level mathematician, he might not know much about music, or somebody like Zakir Hussain or one of these musicians, they might not know much about technical mathematics, right? But in the ancient days, every person was good in maths, used to sing, used to compose poems, was an astronomer, or astrologer, so they were all, you know, multiple people in one person. So this one beautiful concept is taught. So this question comes, when you create music, you want to stick to a rhythm, right? You want to stick to a rhythm. Why do we like listening to songs and why we don't like listening to a baby crying? Both are songs. I mean, the mother likes the baby crying, but somebody else might feel it is irritated. Why? What is the difference then? The thing is, it's not just sound that makes music, it is the rhythm that makes the music. When the beat is there, you feel like clapping your feet to it, you feel like dancing, you feel like clapping your hands, that's when the song becomes catchy or entertaining, and that's when you internalize the song and you enjoy it. But if there is no rhythm, if there is no tune or whatsoever, it is just a random sound like a baby crying or a horn of a car or that frequency thing that the mic does all of a sudden when somebody's speaking, it makes that high frequency note. There are sounds, but they're not pleasant to hear because there's absence of music. So what happens is, rhythm is nothing but numbers. What does rhythm say? Every line in the song that you sing should take the same amount of time. That's all that rhythm says. That's the meaning of rhythm. Every line should take the same amount of time. Every line of the song. So that when you hear, you will automatically go into this number cycle. Without your knowledge, you'll start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the repetition of that cycle will be pleasing to your body because of the monotony of the beat, because of the rhythm. If the song is in different rhythms, you won't even feel like listening to it. You won't find anything nice in it. So let's say that our song, which we are creating, should have 4 beats in it, a rhythm of 4, let's say 4 seconds, time duration of 4 seconds. Seconds is just a unit of time. I mean, you can't say how much is 1 second or is 1 second the actual unit of time, but let's say 4 units. So what happens in music is, when ancient poets used to create music, they had 2 tools to use. They just had 2 tools. One was what they called the riswaswara, the short vowel like the k or the or t or the very small vowels, or the dirghaswara, which was long, like a or ku or ga or these kind of longer vowels. They just had 2 things at them, 1 and 2, based on the time duration. One was short, one was long. And we call it 1 and 2, they used to call the 2 as a guru and they used to call the 1 as a lagu. Don't get worried by the notation, I'm just telling you what they referred. So what was their goal now? To arrange this 1 and 2 in such a way that it will add up to 4. Because the song had 4 beats. If the song was for 6 beats, then they would want to add up to what? 6. If it's 8 beats song, 8. Now in which way can you arrange this 1 and 2 such that it adds up to 4? Simple. The first method is 1, 1, 1, and 1. Second method is what? You might tell it is 1, 2, 1. Somebody else will say 2, 2. But the problem with this listing is, we don't know if we have left out any combination. Now I have listed down 3. I don't know if I have listed down all the possible combinations. There are some which are missing, right? There is one more, that is a 2, 1, 1. Or there is 1, 1, 2. So how do you list them in such a way that you don't miss out anything? Now 4 is a very small number. Very small number. You can easily notice that totally there will be 5 combinations. Take a number like 8. There happens to be what? 34 different combinations to add up to 8. If you try to list it in a manual process, what are the chances that all the 34 will be some might be left out, right? So you have to have a foolproof algorithm such that nothing is left out. This one example I want to give you to show the beauty of the minds of those ancient scholars. So they came up with this method of listing. So they said, so now G stands for what? 2, that is the guru. L stands for 1, that is the lagu. So they said, you start with as many gurus as possible. Let's list for 6. They said, start with as many gurus as possible. So how many gurus can you start with? 6 gurus? 3 gurus. Because each guru stands for 2. So we start with G, G, and G. Now they tell the process as, you start looking at the letter from the left side of the word. I think this is the word. You start from the left side. And the first time you see a G, you replace it with a L. So now we are coming from this side, scanning from the left. We found a G, what do we do? Put an L. They say that remaining things, leave them as they are and just copy down from the previous combination. So this becomes G as well as G. Now what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to add these numbers, say 1, 2 and 2. If you add, you're getting 5. How much is remaining? 1. So you put what? L to the left side. Now here comes the doubt. What if the number that is remaining is more than 2? So that time they tell you that put as many G's as possible. So first put a G. Now suppose this here 2 was remaining, I'll put a G first. And then I will try to fill the L's. So now again, let's follow this process from here, scanning from the left. When I get a G, what do I do? L. Copy down the right side as it is. Now the sum is 3.
G.
I can put a G, right? First I put a G. Can I put another G? No, I put an L. Again, start scanning from the left. Found a G, replace it with an L. Copy this as it is. Now 1, 2 and 4. 2 is remaining. So I put a G. Start scanning from the left. 1, 2, 3, 5. I have to put one L. Start scanning from the left. Everything is an L. Ignore. Meet the G. Replace it with an L. Now 1, 3, 5, 7, 8. And then 1, 3, 5, 6. No, 1,
3.
Previous one is
1.
Okay. 1, 3, 5, 6. Yes, sorry. Okay. Again, start scanning from the left. L, G, L, and G. Again, L, L, G, L. 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. 1, 2, 4, and 6. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now see, we don't know how many combinations there are, but till when do we go on listing? So the method says that you stop when you reach all L's. Then you can't do anything, right? What is the process? You have to replace the G with an L. So if there is no G, you stop. So you say 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Is that done? Or is there one more G which we can put here? We can put one more G and then it comes all 6 L's. So now if we count the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. There are 13 different ways of adding up to which number? 6. Using which numbers? 1 and 2. L and G. You might ask, is there a way of directly telling how many ways there are so that we can verify our method? Now I told you that for 4 there are 5 ways, for 6 there are 13 ways. Wouldn't it be nice if we saw a pattern in it, so somebody gave us a larger number like 8, when we start listening we say, okay, for 8, these many combinations should be there, have I missed out anything? So it turns out that this, again, was discovered long ago by a poet called Acharya Hemachandra. He, again, was a musician, wanted to create music, saw this wonderful pattern, which we now call the Fibonacci sequence. Professor Prabhu mentioned it in his introduction. He said, I'm going to talk about the Fibonacci sequence. This was what he was talking about. We call it the Fibonacci sequence because it was discovered by Fibonacci. And he made it very famous to the world. But there are two things in maths. One is discovering it and one is publicizing it. So should we give the name to the one who publicized the thing or should we give the name to the one who discovered the thing? The one who discovered the thing, right? Now there are some people who say that Fibonacci actually found some ancient Indian texts and he got this idea and then he didn't want to tell that he learned it from the Indians and he gave his own name. But those are rumors. So we shouldn't blame Fibonacci. Maybe he discovered it by himself. But maybe we don't have to give him the name for it. We can agree that Fibonacci also discovered this same sequence. But maybe somebody else did it before it. So I don't know how they did it. To add up to one, how many possible ways are there using L and G? There's only one possible way. L. Can't put any G. So for one, there is one possible way. To add up to two, before that, let's to add up to zero, how many possible ways are there? To add up to zero using one and two, how many ways are there? How many ways is zero? Is it 0 or is it 1? We can say it is 1 because not writing anything itself is one way of writing it. So that comes in the permutations and combinations. It's like, so somewhat like, you know, I want to add up to 0 using 1 and 2, and there's only one way to do it by not writing anything. So actually, to add up to 0 also there is one way. To add up to 2, there are two ways. One is L and L, one is G. So then this turns out to be the Fibonacci sequence. You add up to 3, there are 3 possible ways. You add up to 4, there are 5 possible ways. And here the sequence comes. So 13 happens to be the 6th Fibonacci numbers. So to add up to 6 using 1 and 2, there are 13 different ways. Question to you, which I don't know myself. Can you prove that using 1 and 2 to add up to any number, the total number of combinations are the nth Fibonacci number? Is there a way to prove it? Nobody knows. The thing with ancient Indian maths is we have all the answers. We don't know from where the question came. We don't know how they thought of this thing. Did he actually with brute force go on listening and notice this pattern? Or did he conceive of the pattern and then he listed up the combinations? We don't. Why we don't know? Because they are not alive for us to ask them. And there was no internet at that time for them to blog about it or to post on Facebook about it. So there is no proof about it. Unfortunately, we can try and imagine what might have happened. That's all we can do. We can't be sure about it. So think about this. Can you prove why the sequence comes from this? Because the moment we put three variables, I tell you L, G, and then I put something else which stands for 3, then this sequence doesn't continue. The sequence will completely change. The Fibonacci sequence comes only when you use just 1 and 2. Okay, fine, just pause for some time about this music. You can think about it, and while you think about it, I would like to talk about the second aspect of my show, which is called Mathemagic. So this was inspired by Professor Arthur Benjamin's TED talk, which he gave, I think, maybe 10 years back. I saw the video, I really got inspired, I wanted to do what he did. And somehow, due to God's grace, I'm able to do this now. And I wish to present Mathemagic before you. The intention of this session, the Mathemagic session, is to tell you all that maths can also be used to have fun, which most of us feel is wrong. Most of us feel that this is our enemy. Who in the world created this subject? Why should we learn this? All these theorems and all that. To change that perception, I go around schools and colleges trying to give them a feel that numbers can be a lot more entertaining than what they think it is. Okay, let's begin. What do you mean by squaring of a number? You take a number and multiply it by itself, right? So what is 5 squared? What is 6 squared? What is 947 squared? Something big. Okay? Something big. Fine. I would like to do a challenge here. How many of you have calculators with you? Can you please come on stage? I asked the question first, how many of you have calculators? Because if I ask how many of you are willing to come on stage with the calculators, some of your calculators will not even appear. So first, if I ask if the calculator exists, then there is a possibility of getting a volunteer. Can you please come on stage? So, okay, is that a scientific calculator?
Yep.
Okay, no problem. Okay, fine, I would like to do this challenge. I will square 2-digit numbers in my head and I will try to erase him and when he's using the calculator.
I'm not that perfect.
Okay, that's fine. Don't accept defeat so quickly. So let's do this randomly. I want people from the audience to call out any 2-digit number of their choice. Now, make it difficult. 2-digit number doesn't mean you should give 20, 30, 40. Very easy to square those. But don't give numbers like 25, 35, 45. That is also very easy to square. You'll know that method, right? You can multiply it by the next number and then add 25. Give me some tough two digit number. Should I write the answer on the board or should I just tell it as you tell it to me? I should tell. Start, give me a two digit number. 96 squared is 9216. Next. 33 squared is 1089. 7569.
August date?
5th.
Saturday. Same as you. Now, you might again think that I memorized every year from 1980 onwards to now. So, somebody wants to give me a year which is before, any year before, you know, 1800 or 2000, 2100, somebody wants to predict the future. You can verify it on your phone calendar if it is not your birthday. So, can you give me some tough date? Somebody else. Sir, you give. Which year? Yes, sir.
Again you get 747 and again you get 747.
So now adding up row, same answer, it happens in every magic square. There's nothing special about it. Any magic square in any textbook will give that same thing. Now let's add the columns. Here 9 plus 149 is 158, 158 plus 300 is 458, plus 289 is also 747. Here 57, 158, 455, and also 747. Here you get 1, 142, 450, and 747. And here you get 400, 605, 698, and 747. Now what is remaining? Let's try diagonal. Let's not leave out any stone method. Let's try diagonal here. 400 plus 141 is 541. 541 plus 9 is 550. Plus 197 is also 747. And here, this diagonal, 289 plus 101 is 390, 698, and 747. Now, this thing will work out for any magic square, and there's nothing really great about it. But for this audience, I wanted something slightly special. So I thought, okay, these 10 combinations will work out. But let's do something different. So, what can we do? Look at these four numbers in the center. Okay, these four numbers. And you add them together. They are not row or column or diagonal. They're just four numbers in the center. You add them together, what do you get? 197 plus 101 is 298. 298 plus 308 is 606. 606 plus 141 also happens to be what? 747. Now, let's divide this box into four parts, like this, okay? Can you guess what's going to happen? Just act like you don't know, let's check it out. These four numbers, add them together. 9 plus 39 is 401, 401 plus 149 is 555, 555 plus 197 is also 747. Here we get 297, 346, 437, 439, and also 747. Here we get 300, 401, 458, and 747. Here we get 141, 346, 347, and 747. Did I stop there? No, I wanted more. You had 9 plus 392 plus 289 plus 57. You get 747. 392 plus 297 plus 57 plus 1. You get 747. 297 plus 49 plus 1 plus 400. You get 747. Should I go on saying all the numbers? No, right? This one plus this one plus this one plus this one is 747. This one plus this one plus this one plus this one is 747. This is 747. This is 747. This is 747. I add these two and these two, I get 747. I add these two and these two, I get 747. If I add these four, I get 747. These four, I get 747. These four, I get 747. Two more options. Don't get bored. These four, 149 plus 101 is 252. 555 plus 197 is also 747. These four numbers, 308, 249, 542, and 747. Then, there is one last combination that works out. You look at these four numbers in the corner and you add them together. What do you get? 9 plus 49 is 58, 58 plus 289 is 347, 347 plus 400 is 747, but those four numbers, 9, 49, 400, 289, all of these are square numbers, and if you take the square root, you get 3, 7, 20, 3rd of July 2017, which happens to be today's date. So, it shows that today's date is really very special. That is why this magic square is possible. Okay? Now, before I go to the last part of my talk, it's a very risky thing that I want to do. That is, there's a little bit of volume which I want to show you for like 5 minutes, but then there's something really risky which I want to do, which I've not done for almost 1 year now. That is doing a 5-digit square. So, I did 2-digit, 3-digit, 4-digit squares, but doing 5-digit square, I've done it only twice in my life so far, and not for the last 1 year, but somehow I feel like doing it today. I might make a mistake there, but anyway, I just want to try it.
The last workshop you did for 4, right?
I did it for 4, yeah. 5-digit is very tricky. The answer goes to billions, but I don't want to attempt it for today. So before that, I want to show you why exactly I got my violin here today. I want to get my tabla, else I would demonstrate the whole Fibonacci sequence on the tabla. If you are interested, you can go on YouTube and you can search my name and you can type Matha Music. You'll get about 3 or 4 videos where I have showed how tabla is important in representing the Fibonacci sequence. It's a very, very simple video. You'll be able to understand it. Unfortunately, due to the rainy season, I was not able to bring it. So now, since we have spoken about magic squares, I'd like to tell you how you can play music using magic squares. So I will do a very simple magic square such that the sum total is 16. Sum total is 16. I will use the same numbers so that our job is easy. Okay, this is just to demonstrate to you how we can use music to play mathematics. Do we have around 10 more minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. After that, maybe I just would like to take 2 or 3 questions, so I just want to finish off in 10 minutes. Now, this box, whichever way you add, row, column, diagonal, all the things which I told you, the answer will be what? 16. How can we use this wonderful property of this box in something like violin? How many swaras are there in Indian classical music?
7.
Sa, ri, ga, ma, ga, da, ni, sa. So let's say 8 for the convenience. Let's say the sa is another swara. So 8 swaras are there. Now instead of saying 1, I will say sa. For 2, I will say sa, ri. Not just ri, sa, ri. 2 is longer than 1, so we have to play both the notes. For 3, I will say sa, ri, ga. 4 will be sa ri ga ma, 5 will be sa ri ga ma pa, 6 will be sa ri ga ma pa da, 7 will be sa ri ga ma pa da ni, 8 will be sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa. And if at all the number comes greater than 8, you can go up to sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa ri ga ma. You can keep doing whatever you want. So now, 1 is, 2 is, 3 is, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 is. Familiar? Now how do we play music using a magic square? I know one thing for sure. Music needs rhythm. What is rhythm? Every line should add up to the same amount of time. I know another thing for sure. In this box, whichever way I add, the final answer will be same. Can you put 2 and 2 together and say what we can do? We can just go on playing each row, each column, or diagonal, and since all of them added to the same number, there will be rhythm induced automatically. If I play the first row, 4, 4, 4, 4, it will be total is 16, right? Why did I pick 16? Because 16 is a very base taal, it's called teen taal, 16. Most of the bhajans or songs, they all come to 16 beats, even film songs. Generally, they're 8 or 4 or 16, they're in powers of 2. So now the next one becomes 2, 6, 8 and 0. For 0 what? Playing nothing. Because 2, 6 and 8 itself will add up to 16. So 2 will be, 6 will be, and 8 will be. So if I play it together, it will be. Total will still be 16. You play the first one and the second one after the another. Both will take the same amount of time. See, the first one is. Some 30-40 combinations, he will get that many different ways of playing the same raga and arriving at the same number. So you just have to memorize all the combinations and go on playing. It will keep adding up to the same answer. Is that clear? Did you understand what is the how it is applicable? You can do it not only on violin, on any instrument you can do it. And not only for the same raga, so you can change the raga, it will sound different. Again, now I played in the raga which is called Shankarabharana, which goes like this. If I change the raga, it will sound something like. Or if I change it to another raga, it will be. But since total notes are 8, whichever raga you use, it will still work out. And one last raga I want to show will be. The ma is slightly different. Remaining all the things are same. The ma is slightly different. Notice. So each note has different ways of playing. Re does not mean re is not just one thing. There are three different re's, which you know different songs. They're still re, but they sound different. Fine. Should I do the questions first, or should I try to do my 5-digit square?
5-digit square.
Okay. Now, assume that my show is over. In case I make a mistake, okay? In case I make a mistake, think that the show is already over. This thing I'm doing as an additional. Suppose I get it right, think that it is part of the show.
4-digit is patent in 2013. 5-digit should be patent today.
Okay. So I did a 5-digit square 1 year back, but I don't know if I can still do it now. There are chances of getting an error. So let's try. Can somebody give me a 5-digit number greater than 10,000, smaller than 1 lakh? 97,027. Now this might go wrong, okay? Please forgive me if I do make a mistake. And to make it interesting for you, what I will do is, instead of doing the calculation in my head and just writing the answer, I will just do the calculation out loud. So I will speak out whatever is coming in my mind. So it might sound rubbish to you, you might think I am a madman, I don't mind. But I want you to know what are the things that go in my mind when I am doing a calculation of this size. So in the middle you might even hear certain words. You might think, what is he speaking? The words are actually a way of converting the number into a word so that I remember the word, and then later when I need the number, I convert the word back to the number and then I use it for the calculation. So that's what, if at all you hear a word, I'm not sure if I will use a word here or no, but I'm just assuring you, don't think something happened to me or something. But how I will do this is, I will divide it into three simple parts, very simple maths equation. I will do 97,000 whole square plus 27 square, and to that I will add 2 into 97,000 into 27. That's which formula? A plus B whole square. So, if at all anybody thought I was using magic math or abacus, I hope now you are sure. I didn't use any other formula other than A plus B whole square for any of my calculations. Fine, shall we begin? 3, 2, 1. Prashant problem number 97 times 27. 97 times 27 times 2 is 27 times 200 minus 27 times 0. 27 times 97 is 2,790 minus 2,619. Is that sure? 27 times 3 is 81. So 2,790 minus 2,619 divided by 5,238. 5,238. This 97 squared is 9,004. So I say 9 billion. The 4,009 5,238 5,409 is 414 million. 238 238 238. Finally, 27 squared 27 squared 27 squared 9 9 divided. The 238 just adds up here. 238,729. Thank you.
Okay.
US. Thank you so much. Okay. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. How much time do we have? What is the time now? It's 4:50. Can we have 2 minutes? Okay. At all, somebody wants to ask something. If you don't get the chance to ask me, this is my email ID. You can email me whatever you wish to ask. Okay, this is my email ID, rnbhat123@gmail.com. By mistake, if you type 1234, that is also my email ID. I'll just take two questions. So if you want to ask me anything, please ask. Related to the show, don't ask me general things like, how did you do this? Just doubts regarding what I spoke with, because we have lack of time. Once again, if you meet, I will answer whatever you want to ask me. Okay. But now since we have lack of time, there's two questions, please. Anybody?
What is the secret formula behind all this?
Big question. How will I tell it in 2 minutes? What is the secret formula behind which?
Behind creating a magic square.
Behind creating a magic square. Now this does not have any formula. That is for sure. It's not a formula. It is a logic, I can say. But I can't even call it a logic because it changes from date to date. So today's date was what? 3rd of July 2017. So instead of doing 3/7/2017, I did 949/400 and 289. So for that, this is a magic square. I can't assure you that if you use the same pattern, you'll get another magic square. Because my rule is that the number shouldn't repeat. In this, obviously, in that boiling magic square, I don't care if the number repeats, that's for music. But when I do this magic square, there should be no repetition. So in this, all numbers are unique. You don't find one number twice. So for that to work out, I don't know what exactly is the formula. There's some logic which I use which I don't know exactly how to explain, but maybe if you keep doing magic squares, you'll get to some sort of a practice where you can do it. I don't know exactly what is the way to explain. Any other question? Right now, zero, but for the last, when I began, maybe, I don't know, when I first saw that video, I used to practice all night on squaring numbers and all that. But then to achieve this speed, it took me about 3 years, 4 years or so. To do the fighting square, as you saw, I was very scared of doing it because it can go wrong most of the times. So yeah, I did practice a lot. I don't know exactly how much, but right now, it may not be that much, but definitely till last year, I practiced a lot. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Raghvendra, for a very nice talk on Mathematica music.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to put a note on one point. He is from a very noble family from Manipal. His family is an entrepreneurial family. His parents run the Manipal.net. Dr. Narsim Bhatt, who is a PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. He is also a gold medalist from MIT. His dad, he did his MA from University of Science, Bangalore. And his uncle, Dr. Prashant Bhatt, he has done his engineering from NITK and his MA from IISc Bangalore and PhD from UCLA. And also, there are three brothers, Dr. Srikanth Bhatt. So three brothers, they run an entrepreneurial firm here, Manipal.net, who I should not say perform, who make world-class projects, specifically on electronics and communication engineering. One of them I always admire is the wireless blood pressure meter. Beautiful man. With these few words, I would like to thank this young lad and I wish you all success. God bless you. You should be on the top of the world, not even Stanford and Berkeley is enough for you. I need something more than that. Now, with these few words, I request for Sir Raghavan to hand over a memento to Raghavendra. Sir.